Ladies and gents, this is the moment you've waited for.
Now, I know this video is going to be very much kind of involves a lot of people's different opinions and feelings and things like that to do with, you know, a whole spectrum of different conditions, how it affects them and all this other kind of stuff. Obviously, my own personal experiences reflect me. It doesn't mean to say it's the way everybody feels. And same with the other, you know, guys that were involved in the interview, Shannon and Amy and Dave.
University of Gloucestershire, and I have fibromyalgia, which is a bitch.
What for those who don't know, and obviously a lot of people, you know, are unfamiliar with the term invisible illness and all the conditions that sort of encompass that description, what is fibromyalgia?
Oh, so fibromyalgia is a chronic pain and fatigue condition. But it also gives you things like brain fogs, so disrupts your kind of cognitive ability, lots of other things, memory loss, depression. It's basically like a big clusterfuck of symptoms that they chuck you away. It's great.
Is the term fibromyalgia sort of like a blanket term for lots of other different kind of things that go into what make up fibromyalgia?
No. So
actual condition, is it just with yes. lots of symptoms?
Yeah, it's quite difficult to diagnose, but it is possible to diagnose it by seeing which symptoms go together, similar in many ways to things like ME.
Oh right, okay.
And lupus, but it's not quite the same.
Yeah. Okay. So do you know what the main differences are that distinguish it between things like ME and lupus and?
I think the main one's the pain issue. Not that I'm not saying ME is not incredibly painful, because I know it is. I've got a few friends with it. But I think like the main symptom with fibromyalgia is the chronic pain.
Right.
And it differs loads from person to person. So I know some people so my mum has fibromyalgia, but in a completely different form to how I have it, so and it's not as intense. But I've also known other people who've ended up in wheelchairs because of fibromyalgia, so it's a very sliding scale.
So it's a bit like a spectrum kind of thing. Many people would get it on different levels and everything else. It's very personal to each person.
Yeah, it's really personal to each person, and kind of there's kind of an agreement in kind of fibro forums and stuff is you never judge somebody for saying that they've got fibromyalgia just because they've got like fewer pain levels than you, because everybody's having a really shitty time of it, but everyone's having a different type of shitty time, so you know. Yeah. Nice.
You said your mum's got it. Is there any link to it being sort of like a gene kind of thing, or like hereditary, or is it just literally like luck of the shit pool kind of?
They don't know, but to be honest, most of the people that I've spoken to have mentioned another family member who have it. Mm. Because in recognizable terms, it's a relatively new condition that's been, well, it's not a new condition, it's just that it's
recently only been kind of.
Yeah. So in the past kind of 30 years, so there's still a lot of research being done as to like where it comes from, what happens. They don't know exactly how somebody gets it, but it seems to be that, I say it seems to be, I mean, I'm talking about kind of research rather than my own going, I think. it seems to be triggered. It seems to be something that's dormant, which is triggered by trauma, whether that's like a really intense emotional trauma or physical traumas. So like people have had car crashes and stuff like that.
That's memory, that kind of.
Yeah. And PTSD has been known to trigger it. I sometimes wonder if mine was triggered by PTSD because I suffer from that. And that was kind of triggered when I was about 15, 16. Which seems to be when my fibro started presenting itself, although I wasn't diagnosed for like another 10 years.
And it takes that long, does it, to go through the process of actually getting in somewhere where they... Is it the kind of thing where you have to keep kind of pestering them and go through the motions so you're taken seriously with it? Or is it like a kind of thing where they just kind of keep pushing you to the back, well, it's not a real thing kind of thing, or...
A little of both, depending on who your doctor is, really. Yeah, unfortunately. You do have to keep pestering. And also, with me, I just wasn't aware of the condition at all. I thought there was something wrong, but I didn't know what was wrong with me. And I only had my PTSD diagnosed about 2 years ago. So I knew that I wasn't right, but I had nothing to put to it. And for years I kept being told that I was stressed. I was like, this isn't kind of stress back pain, this is agony. And I felt like I was drunk all the time. I was like, I don't understand what's going on. And it wasn't until, I mean, my mum really pushed it when I was a grown up, and I came back to live with her when I was about 22. And I lived with my mum for a couple of years, and she really pushed it for me. She basically, every time I said that there was something wrong, she was writing down what was wrong. And then she put it all into a letter so that when I went to the doctor, rather than me getting all socially anxious and going, oh, I don't know, I'm fine. Everything's cool. I'm British. everything's cool. I could just hand them the letter and go, this is the problem with me.
I know when Shannon was going through, because Shannon's also got it. A favorite thing with doctors I find is that if they're unsure about something, or they can't be bothered, or it's too much work, or they generally don't know how to deal with the situation, their favorite form of kind of go and when do this is a diary.
Oh yeah, they love the diary.
You know, make a log of it, then come back and see me in 5 years, and then we'll discuss it, kind of thing. That's how they dealt with Shannon. Actually, obviously, wasn't aware of the condition, or you know, the strain it has on somebody. And so she was going to the doctors. I think she actually went about 3 or 4 times, because she was saying, oh, she feels down, you know, she feels all these different things, and obviously didn't know what it was. And the doctor actually said to Shannon, well, you know, you look fine to me, you've got makeup on.
What?
And Shannon was like,
What
the fuck? Like, so just because I can put some makeup on and make myself try and feel a bit better about going out, you're now saying to me, my mental health and the condition I, you know, I want diagnosing is, you know, all in my head.
It's so shit. So many people get that.
Yeah. It's
unbelievable.
I was... That affected her, and she thought she... Then that kind of took her down the path of, is it all in my head? Is it like, do I need to... You know, which made it worse, because then she thought she was going mad. And it was just like the spiral of just like trying to do more, but making her worse. And then
it goes round and round. And like with me, I was so like desperately kind of pushing it away and pushing myself through things like full time work and all that stuff. And like holding on to that much pain that I ended up giving myself psychosomatic seizures. They sent me to a doctor, sent me to the specialist for epilepsy, just to make sure it wasn't anything like that. And he said to me, I'm sure you don't want to hear this, but these are psychosomatic. I was like, why would I not want to hear that? Like, yeah. If I know that what's happening is yeah. my body is so stressed that it's making me physically stop by making me drop to the floor, yeah. then I know I can do something about it. I don't want to have epilepsy. It's yeah. horrible. You know, and I feel like people with things like fibro and ME and anything invisible, really, you're treated yeah. like a hypochondriac in so many places.
Yeah.
Especially, at school, that's all I was told constantly, what a hypochondriac I was. I mean, my mum used to make jokes about me being a hypochondriac, you know, which I'm sure she must feel awful about now. but you are constantly treated like a hypochondriac. The first time I did a production of, it was 9 to 5, the musical, because I do a bit of Amdram. Mm. And one of the leads, she's a midwife,
okay.
a wonderful woman. And I had to sit out of one of the dances because I was starting to feel really painful. And I sat down, and she wasn't in it. And she sat down next to me, and she said, "Are you all right?" And I said, "Oh yeah, I've got fibromyalgia, so sometimes it's difficult." And she put her hand on my knee, and she said, "I'm so sorry." And that's the first time anyone had actually acknowledged
that
it was something difficult to go through, and I bawled my eyes out because I was like, I've never had that validation from like a professional. And then I found this wonderful doctor who unfortunately has since retired, who was wonderful. Roger was brilliant. I'd go in and we'd try new things, and he'd be like, "Oh, I've been doing some research, and some of these studies say that this helps. Do you want to give it a go?" Which is brilliant. I think it's absolutely wonderful. I'm perfectly willing to try pretty much anything. I will still scoff at people when they say, "Oh, have you tried yoga?" Because I get a lot of that. Like, yes, I have tried yoga. I do a bit of yoga. It does help a little bit, but you know, it doesn't cure. So yeah.
Unbelievable. So when you're talking about going out doing like the Amdram kind of stuff and work and things like that, how does having this kind of, obviously with the pain and the fatigue and the mind fog stuff, does it have a major impact on just what you would physically do in a normal day?
Yeah, absolutely. I had to give up full time, and then I had to give up part time. And I became my own boss because it was the only way that I could work and manage the condition. So I do voiceover from home. I'm a singer as well, so I sometimes do singing gigs, stuff like that. But there was absolutely no way I could carry on working normally. One of the issues that I really have is with the chronic fatigue is the mornings are so painful if you get me out of bed too soon. It hurts so much. And sometimes I can't move at all when I wake up, and it takes me like a good half an hour to actually get the various bits and pieces moving. And obviously if you've got a 9-to-5 job, you can't do that. It's kind of a problem.
Shannon, she has to be at work for 8, and she has to set her alarm for 5:30.
Yeah.
For an hour and a half to kind of prepare herself to get up. Yeah, absolutely.
That is amazing. That's amazing that she does that. Yeah. Wow.
Yeah, I want to.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Yeah.
Like anyone.
But I do the odd bit of Amdram. Obviously, I can't do too many shows in a row. They've got to be really aware of what's going on with me. And that I sometimes, obviously, rehearsals, sometimes I will just have to sit there in a little blanket and watch what's going on and keep going in my head. I trained to be an actor. I trained professionally down in London, and it was always my dream to do it. And to discover that I had something that meant I physically would not be able to perform night after night, that it would, you know, it would just kill me, was really hard to kind of accept that. And I held on to that pipe dream until about 3 years ago. Because it's really hard to let go when you spent your entire life.
I can't imagine, really. It'd be like me losing an arm.
So about 3 years ago, which is when I met my fiance, he encouraged me to kind of try and find an area of that, of like theatre, that I could still be part of professionally. Yeah. Which is why I signed up to do this creative writing degree, to do script writing. And hopefully that's kind of my plan, because I still get to be learning about theatre, and getting involved with theatre stuff, and I love writing. And I've got this idea that I would love to do a like theatre group that's filled with people with invisible disabilities.
Okay.
So actors who have had to give up their work because it's just not tenable to the professional working environment, but to create a space where it is tenable.
Yeah.
Yeah, and write plays specifically for them to do. So that's the new pipe dream now.
It's good to have one. Anybody that doesn't have an ambition is a bit boring, really, aren't they? They've got nothing to work towards.
Yeah, my main ambition at the moment is to be able to leave the house.
Yeah, I think a lot of people share that one.
But I don't want it enough to, you know, go around spreading disease everywhere, so yeah, don't want it that much.
Like the Grim Reaper.
Mm.
But that's what it's like at the moment. You know, it's like in the Family Guy thing where you see him going around and he just touches people and they drop dead. And that's what it's like. It's, you know, I'm scared to touch anything.
I was going around Wilco the other day, because it's where we get our dog food from, our dry food. We can't seem to buy it anywhere else. And I was going around like I was in Die Hard, kind of like just, you go around, kind of jump around corners just to make sure there's nobody there. And like, no. Crawling through the vents. Yeah, it is absolute madness.
So you were saying about having to give up on your, you know, well, move into another area of what you wanted to do.
Yeah.
There's, with this condition and everything else that obviously go along with it, how having to make kind of sacrifices and having to think up new ways of doing what you want to do, does that have a big impact on your like emotional well-being, like learning to accept, you know, well, I can't do that, you know, I'm gonna have to try and find, and is that kind of a positive side of it, where you're kind of pushed into thinking, you know, of doing other things that would normally kind of limit you with what this is?
I mean, I'm stubborn as hell. Which when I was on my own, I would just I would balls out and then just collapse for a week after doing it. But I'm really lucky in that my partner is very brave, because he will say, are you sure that's a good idea? And then he has to deal with 10 minutes of me going, how dare you tell me what to do? I'm an independent woman. And then going, actually, you're completely right. It's a really stupid idea. So yeah, he's a very brave man to stand up to me. I've got very deeply ingrained feminist issues of being told what to do by a man. And he's not telling me what to do at all. He's just pointing out that maybe I need to look after myself a bit. So it is good to find other things to do that are better for me, in terms of not knackering me out. But pacing, I mean, they tell you for years, oh, pacing's really important. Boom and bust, you don't want to boom and bust. And I've been fighting that for such a long time. And the bastards are right. I hate that they're right, but they are. Pacing's everything. I mean, if I've got, normally on a Thursday, I haven't been able to do it because I haven't been very well today, but normally on a Thursday, I have a full day at uni that starts at 10:15 and ends at 5:15. And if I try and do something in the evening on a Thursday, I can't do that. I literally can't do that, because otherwise I will be knocked out for the next like 4 days. It's just not worth it. But equally, if I'm going to be in pain, I would rather be in pain doing something that I love than in pain sat on my sofa.
Yeah. That makes sense.
Yeah.
So things like uni and, you know, wanting to do other things outside of kind of things you have to do, brings us on to the next point of like the effect it has on your kind of daily routine and just living, I suppose, in general. So with this condition and, like we said, everything that comes along with it, is it a struggle? You've already mentioned about, you know, just trying to get up in the morning and things like going to uni puts everything else on hold. What kind of aspects of life does it kind of affect in just trying to do a normal day, I suppose?
Everything, really, because you have to decide which of your day you're going to do, which bits you're going to do. So, again, I'm really lucky because Paul has no problem with chores. He loves cooking. We have a dishwasher. But like, I can't do simple things like that. Paul's great. Everyone needs Paul. I can't unloading the dishwasher. I'll be in agony after doing that, just because of the bending and the way that you move. I couldn't, doing washing up again, absolute agony. Hanging out the washing, carrying the laundry. Sometimes I can't carry anything at all, not even like a glass, because it's too much pressure on my muscles.
So do you have to prioritize your day before you even...
Hello, I suffer from an invisible illness. It's anxiety. The causes vary from person to person. In my case, it was something that built up over 2 or 3 years until I couldn't cope with it. It affected my daily life with my family. I was getting very angry, couldn't seem to control it, and I'd snap at the slightest thing. And there's various cures for it, whether it's relaxation therapy, hypnotherapy, or a tablet route, which is what I'm on. I've been on tablets now for probably about 8 or 9 years, and they control it to a point. I have bad days, and I have good days, you know, and the bad days, when they're really bad, I get very uptight, tense, pains in the chest, panic attack type symptoms. But generally the tablets control it, and I've turned out to be a kind of normal person, if I can use that phrase. But it does have a massive effect, and it's because it's an invisible illness. It's hard sometimes for people who don't suffer from invisible illnesses like depression or anxiety to understand what someone's going through, because from the outside they just look perfectly normal, but that's not necessarily what's going on inside. So the main thing is, I mean, if people are just a bit more patient, a bit kinder, then you know, that would help a lot. And it's not like me or other people are looking for sympathy. I don't want sympathy. I'd just like people to understand a bit more, so that I can cope with it better. There you go. That's my story.
Okay, so fibromyalgia.
Yeah.
What is it?
So it's a long-term chronic illness that causes a hypersensitivity to pain throughout the whole body, and there's lots of other symptoms that come with it. It's very similar to ME, but it's got a lot less research into it.
Okay, what other symptoms do you tend to get with it?
Well, you have extreme tiredness, fatigue, IBS, anxiety, muscle stiffness, headaches. I get migraines almost daily. Fibro fog, they call it. It's basically like, my dad would call it a brain fart, but it's basically where you walk into a room and your mind goes completely blank. You cannot remember why you're in there, what you're doing.
Yeah.
And it's not even just things like that. It's like, it's all day, every day, where you just never really know what you're doing in life.
Okay, so do they know what causes it?
There isn't enough research into what actually causes it. They have a couple of theories. So one theory is to do with trauma, such as a car accident or giving birth, or, you know, like an extreme...
Morris! Out the bin!
An extreme, you know, like, hit to your nervous system that then sort of sends it into shock, which then is what creates the hypersensitivity. That's one theory. Another theory is just like a chemical imbalance. So just, it's just your brain signals not quite sending the pain signals around your body properly.
All right, okay. So is it like a neurological kind of thing to do with the brain?
Yeah, it is, in a way. It's basically, you'd be feeling pain that's not really there, but because your brain is telling you it's there, you're feeling it.
All right. So, talking about research and things like that, what kind of things are they doing to try and find out what, you know, is there a cure? Is there, you know, what methods do you have to go through to get treatment for it?
So at the moment, there is no cure. It is something that once you've got it, you've got to live with it for the rest of your life. There's no way of fixing it. But what they are working on is ways of living with it.
Hmm.
So you go on to like a pain management course. It's a very long waiting list, 6 months. I haven't yet started mine because of the virus. I got kicked off for not attending. Even though I didn't attend because of the virus and because it was cancelled. But they've since sent me a letter of apology to say, you know, sorry about accusing you of not turning to the cancelled therapy.
Yeah.
Anyway, with that though, you know, there's medication, mainly pain medication, antidepressants, that kind of thing, to sort of just sort of keep your body at a particular level. There's physiotherapy, like they say things like swimming is really good. Like you can go to a hydrotherapy pool, because you're not putting any weight on your body, but you're still managing to exercise.
Yeah.
But that's just, you know, short term really, because like I say, you've got this condition for the rest of your life. So that only really works for the time period that you're doing it. Mm. And then after, like, you can go home and be tired because you've been exercising.
Yeah.
And the other thing is cognitive behavioural therapy, where they basically teach you how to convince yourself the pain's not there. Which I personally don't really believe in, because at the end of the day, the pain is there. So, you know, being taught to ignore it isn't really working, but they've sort of run out of ways of trying to help people.
Yeah, I mean, I find it funny because a lot of the stuff I've seen, you know, about social media platforms, especially Instagram and things like that, about how they make people feel worse about their own life because it shows, you know, like a filtered perception of everyone's life. Like you always see the best thing. Like people sat around with like piles of money and jewellery and going out to nights out and parties and things
like that.
Yeah. And things like that. So I just find it funny how there's this one side where it filters down all the crap out of everyone's lives and it shows, you know, people living the best life. But then there's the side that you're talking about, where people are using the same platform to show how bad their lives are, but then boosting themselves up through things like followers, likes, comments, and things like that. So do you think that's them using social media and these platforms to kind of abuse the kind of system in which people normally have to go out and work hard at social media platforms? For example, like they say the average time to get subscribers on YouTube, for example, can be anything up to 4 years to get a significant amount. But then you look at things like Instagram, like what you're talking about, and you know, there's people that start up these channels, you know, with the spoony hashtag and illnesses and things like that, where they go from nothing up to 4,000 or 5,000 followers in the space of, you know, 3 or 4 months.
Yeah, I don't really know what your question is. That's a lovely point, though.
I'm saying, do you think, you know, there's certain people that use it wrongfully?
yeah, to further their definitely. Online career.
And you know, I'm not even saying they're aware that that's what they're doing is hard. And for these people on social media platforms, I do understand why they do it, because they want their story to be known. They want to, you know, spread awareness and everything like that. You know, it is a big thing. But I think sometimes they spend so much time and energy doing that they get sort of wrapped up in it. And things like likes and followers and all that ends up meaning so much more to them than it would to an average person. Because it's like the only form of social interaction they can get. Yeah. Because they're not going out, they're not doing anything, you know, they're in bed or whatever. So it's easy to just be in bed on your phone if you've not...
So that becomes their circle of friends.
Yeah, so it becomes their way of life. And I do get that. But then it gets to the point where when they start to Instagram everything, like people that aren't Instagramming everything, their stories aren't getting heard. So that is a perception, the people that are Instagramming, is the perception of what people think these illnesses are. Because the other ones are sort of in the shadows. Like, for example, I don't put anything, it's just my personal choice, I don't put anything on social media about my illness, because I don't want it to be, you know, like...
What
I don't,
was it fined for?
Yeah, like, I don't want to be Shannon the Spoonie or something, you know. I want to just be me, and unfortunately I have this illness that, at the moment, does control my life. Hopefully at some point it won't, because I'll have learned a lot more about it. I've learned how to deal with it and all that. But I just do not want to become, you know, like, I don't know, like 5,000 people following me and me saying, oh, this is what it is, this is what it is. Because it's not. It's not what it is. It's personal to every single person.
So, something I did want to talk a little bit about was panic attacks. When I was younger, I would suffer really, really badly from them. It's still something I worry about to a degree now. The kind of feeling I used to get, you know, when they'd come on. I'll tell you a story first. I remember the first time I ever really experienced it was, I think I was about 5 or 6, and was sent up to bed one day, and I remember lying in my bed, obviously the lights were off, and just this most overwhelming sense of panic just rushed through me. And it was literally like, if I didn't get out of this room, I was going to die. And I know that sounds really over the top and stupid and silly, which, you know, it is to a degree, but you know, I just had to get out of this room and just be around people. Anyone would have done. And for a 5-year-old, that was pretty terrifying. You know, it was not a normal feeling to have. And the only way it would go is if I went downstairs, and, you know, I was just surrounded by my mum and dad again, you know. But then this progressed and it grew, and it got to the point where, you know, all day I'd be worried, I don't want to feel like that again. It'd be my train of thought throughout the whole day, like just worrying, I hope I don't feel like that again. And then the worry would then grow into me feeling like that. It was like this vicious cycle where, from where it was always on my mind, it would get worse and worse and worse and worse. And then I'd be worried, you know, about bedtime coming, and I'd do everything I could to try and, you know, convince my mum and dad to let me stay up later, you know. And I didn't want to discuss it with them, because how do I explain, as, you know, this little boy, that I don't want to be on my own, you know. I would have just been, well, I'm not saying they would have thought this, but, you know, in my mind at that age, you know, they would have just said to me, oh, don't be stupid, just go to bed. And that brought other kinds of worries, and, you know, about how, like, I can't tell them, they'll think I'm stupid, and all these other different things that became associated with it in my mind.
And so it got to the point where, I mean, this went on for years. I mean, I'm talking, it went on to my early 20s, these attacks and these feelings and things like that. And just constantly being on your mind, you know, for 15 years, you know, that's a hell of a long time. And it got to the point where, you know, I try and develop sort of coping strategies and like ways to take my mind off it. Like, if I went to bed, I put like a film on or something, and I'd physically in my mind talk through what I was seeing in the film. So like, something I used to watch a lot was Peter Kay. So he'd walk out obviously on stage, and I'd be like, okay, Peter, wearing a blue top, you know, he's walking over there, he's moving the page, and it would just keep my mind occupied of just literally narrating in my head what was happening on screen. And then once I kind of relaxed into what I was doing, it was more or less certain that I wouldn't get this. It was the initial kind of shock of like, I'm trapped in, I'm on my own. And thoughts would go through my head. I mean, it was very much a kind of situation where like I wasn't in control of my own thoughts. It's a really hard thing to try and explain, and unless you've had one. You genuinely thought you was going, if you didn't remove yourself from this situation, it felt like you was going to die. And I'm not saying that, you know, with any sort of lightheartedness. That is genuinely how it feels. And like I said, this went on till I was in my early 20s. Work. And I used to be a carer, like a social services, kind of like young adult worker. And that in itself was a whole, like, how can I look after young people, like, with this thing, like, I don't know how to deal with. Like, I never went to the doctor with this or never sought any treatment. It was just the kind of thing where, you know, and another thing that really worried me was the fact I used to do, like, sleeping. So I'd have to stay overnight in these people's houses, you know, and hope to God I wouldn't get one. Because I'd never, thank God, touch wood, I was never in a situation where I couldn't remove myself from, and that's the only time where if I would have had one, I don't know what would have happened or what I would have done. But one day I spoke to my parents about it, and I remember sitting down with my dad, and I was absolutely terrified of telling my dad, because I thought he'd think I was stupid, you know. But, you know, he sat me down and he used to have them, you know, and he explained to me, you know, he talked me all through it and everything else. And he said, like, basically, if you ever feel like that, just, you know, ring me up. Like, it doesn't matter what time of day it is, you know, like, just ring me up and, you know, I'll talk to you. And it's weird because literally to that day, the minute I found out that there was this line where, you know, I didn't have to be on my own, it just relieved all the pressure off, you're stuck here with no one to speak to, you know, you can't leave. You know, and just knowing that, you know, those three words, give me a ring, you know, literally, and I don't know whether it was for whatever reason or I just don't know, but that day they stopped. And I've never had one since. You know, now I can stay on my own. I often stay, you know, here at home on my own if Shanna goes away. And I'm fine. I enjoy it. It's not a worry to me anymore. And I know that if I ever did get another one, or I felt anxious or worried about anything, that I could give my dad a ring, I could ring my sisters up. You know, there's loads of different paths for me to go down. I can ring Shannon up, obviously, her dad. So I think the biggest thing I've learned from going through all that kind of period of, you know, panic attacks, anxiety, because I think they are linked. You know, I used to get anxious about having the panic attacks, then that would just put me in that kind of state to get them more, because my mind would constantly be going over and over about them. So I think the biggest thing you can do to help somebody who has panic attacks is just let them know they have the option, and the resources that if they do get one, just say, you know, it's absolutely fine. You know, if you feel like that, just, you know, take 5 minutes, go outside, you know, it's not a problem. You know, they'd rather have that option and to let them know you understand and that they will be okay. It will pass. You know, just give them 5 minutes and, you know, sit down with them, just reassure them, you know, that, you know, everything's all right. So, I mean, that's the experience I've had with anxiety and panic attacks. And it hands down, one of the scariest things I've ever had to deal with. So, that's my story of panic attacks and anxiety. So, there's some thought-provoking points from everybody there. Like I said earlier in the video, these are personal opinions. They are what the people believe who spoke. They're not saying they're right, it's just what they believe. So please be respectful of their opinions. If you agree, brilliant, pop a comment down below. If you disagree, let us know why in the comments. But do just bear in mind that these are personal conditions that these people live with, and it's just how they feel. They're not saying that their point of view is right. So guys, that's the end of this episode. Thank you to everybody who did the Skype interview, sent me clips in. Thank you to Joy, Amy, Shannon, Dave, and thank you to everybody who supported the channel so far. It means, you know, a lot to me that you were all watching and subscribed. Don't forget to follow my Twitter, my Instagram, add me on Facebook, and subscribe to this channel. Check out the previous episodes as well. They're all listed below. And thank you for watching. I can't get my breath, pain beating in my chest. Got nothing left. Kind of feels like life or death. I got a feeling of fear. Don't know why I'm here. Keep thinking that you're near. Telling me, hold on. It's gonna be alright. It's gonna be alright. Somehow it's gonna be alright. Stop and breathe. Stop and breathe. On my face.